to our program, my presentation will be much shorter than the first. This is largely because the search for copy of Archive at Columbia does not contain material related to the Sixth Sinatra. This work was composed in the Soviet Union in 1940, and as such, it belongs on the other side of the line that divides Prokofiev's biography. It's also the line that cuts the archival legacy of Serge Prokofiev. There's the material that we have at Columbia, which is related to the period when he was in the West, and then there's the material from the period of his time in the USSR, which is in state archives in Russia. But we do have some items at Columbia that help set the stage for what was to come in the later years. Prokofiev made his first trip back to the Soviet Union in 1927, after 9 years of living abroad. This on the screen is a copy of his diary from that trip, and it reveals the composer's deep attachment to his homeland, but it also betrays his recognition of the darker strains of Soviet society. In the coming years, though, Prokofiev eagerly made trips back and forth between Russia and the West, and increasingly played a role as a sort of cultural ambassador between the two cultures. But Prokofiev also knew that he had to negotiate his place between the USSR and the West very carefully. He never felt quite at home in the US or Europe, and he never considered himself a Russian emigrant. And the Soviet state didn't consider him a Russian emigre either. And this fact is illustrated clearly in this letter that you see on the screen. This was a letter that he received in 1930, where the Soviet consul in Paris asks Prokofiev to please write to a French newspaper that had called him an emigre, and implored Prokofiev that he has such a record straight, that he is a Soviet citizen. It's chilling to read this letter today, when we know what happened to Prokofiev and his family, his wife and their two young sons, after they relocated permanently to the USSR in 1936. The heavy hand of authoritarianism soon shut the door behind them, cutting them off from professional and personal ties in the West. The works that Prokofiev composed in his Soviet years are among his most famous: Peter and the Wolf, The Scores of the Eisenstein Films, Romeo and Juliet, War and Peace, and of course, Sonatas 6, 7, and 8, the so-called war sonatas, the first of which we'll hear in a few moments. The themes of irony and interruption can clearly be applied to the trajectory of Prokofiev's life in the USSR. On the one hand were commissions and celebrity status that he had been promised, but on the other hand was the increasing chokehold on his creativity. And again, we have a historical backdrop. This was the time of World War II, of Stalinism, of the purges, and of the Gulag. In 1948, when their marriage deteriorated and living separately, Lena Prokofiev was arrested for treason. She had been in contact with some foreign embassies trying to get out of the USSR. And she was in a prison camp in the Arctic Circle, near the Arctic Circle, when Serge Prokofiev died on March 5th, 1950. But news of Prokofiev's death would actually travel quite slowly. Among the many tragic twists of fate in Prokofiev's story is that his death went virtually unnoticed at the time that it happened. And that's because the country was in shock from the death of Joseph Stalin, who died on the very same day as Prokofiev. But the last thing that I want to do is end my presentation on that note. So I want to bring us back to the composer. Although by then the map of his world became much smaller than it had been at the beginning of his life, Prokofiev held on to an image of himself as effortlessly international, as he had been at the start and the middle of his career. As Cindy starts to play the sixth sonata, I think that the complexities and the contradictions of Prokofiev's biography, and indeed the irony and interpretation, will reveal themselves as profoundly in the music as they did in his time, his life, and his space.